Welcome, welcome to Kewanee First United Methodist and our Good Friday service. I'm delighted that you can be here with us here in the sanctuary, but also for those who may be watching our broadcast on Comcast or YouTube or Facebook Live, welcome, welcome, welcome. A couple of real quick announcements, two to be exact. Tomorrow at 9 o'clock, our church will host a drive-through Easter event, and it will run from 9 to 11 tomorrow, and so feel free to come, and or if you have family or friends or neighbors, please tell them about this opportunity. Again, due to COVID, we're not doing our normal Easter egg hunt and those kinds of activities. We're having a drive-through event. And so feel free to join us, 9 a.m. to 11, I believe. Is that correct? 12, sorry, thanks. So, join us. Also, Easter morning, we will have worship here at 9 a.m. as we normally would. There is no sunrise worship service or breakfast. And so join us for Easter, 9 a.m. here in the church sanctuary. Okay? Super. If you would, those of you who have a bulletin, hear our call to worship, and it should be up on the screen as well. On this day, we gather to remember Jesus, our Savior, who loved us and gave himself for us. Let us draw near in full assurance of God's endless love and mercy. Amen.
Oh, just as well you didn't hear me anyway. I'm reading the Psalter, and it's Psalm 22, 1 through 11. My God, why have you forsaken me? Oh my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer. Yet you, the praise of Israel, are enthroned in holiness. To you they cried and were saved. But I am a worm and not a human. All who see me mock at me. He committed his cause to the Lord. Let the Lord deliver him. Let the Lord rescue him. For the Lord delights in him. Upon you I was cast from my birth, and since my mother bore me, you have been my God.
please join with me in hymn 363, "And Can It Be That I Should Gain?" Old Testament scripture reading tonight comes to us from Isaiah 52:13 through 53:12. See, my servant will act wisely. He will be raised and lifted up and highly exalted. Just as there were many who were appalled at him, his appearance was so disfigured beyond that of any man, and his form marred beyond human likeness. So he will sprinkle many nations, and kings will shut their mouths because of him. For what they were not told, they will see, and what they have not heard, they will understand. Who has believed our message, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him like a tender shoot, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and familiar with suffering. Like one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised and we esteemed him not. Surely he took up our infirmities and carried our sorrows. Yet we considered him stricken by God, smitten by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. We are all like sheep have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own dwelling, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away. And who can speak of it to his descendants? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgression of my people he was stricken. He was assigned a grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, though he had done no violence, nor was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the Lord's will to crush him and cause him to suffer. And though the Lord makes his life a guilt offering, he will see his offspring and prolong his days. And the will of the Lord will prosper in his hand. After the suffering of his soul, he will see the light of his life and be satisfied. By his knowledge, my righteous servant will justify many, and he will bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will give him a portion among the great, and he will divide the spoils with the strong, because he poured out his life unto death and was numbered with transgressors. For he bore the sin of many and made the intercession for the transgressors. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Tonight's New Testament reading is from John 18, verse 1. I'm sorry, we've got a revised edition. This is about the death of Jesus Christ, starting with John 1:28. Later, knowing that all was now completed, and so the scriptures would be fulfilled, Jesus said, "I am thirsty." A jar of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked a sponge in it, put the sponge on a stalk of the hyssop plant, and lifted it up to Jesus' lips. When he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." With that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Now it was the day of preparation, and the next day was to be a special Sabbath. Because the Jews did not want the bodies left on the cross during the Sabbath, they asked Pilate to have the legs broken and the bodies taken down. The soldiers therefore came and broke the legs of the first man, who had been crucified with Jesus, and then those of the other. But when they came to Jesus and found that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced Jesus' side with a spear, bringing a sudden flow of blood and water. The man who saw it has given testimony, and his testimony is true. He knows that he tells the truth, and he testifies so that you also may believe. These things happened so that the scriptures would be fulfilled. Not one of his bones would be broken. And as another scripture says, they will look on the one that they have pierced. Later, Joseph of Arimathea asked Pilate for the body of Jesus. Now Joseph was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly, because he feared the Jews. With Pilate's permission, he came and took the body away. He was accompanied by Nicodemus, the man who earlier had visited Jesus at night. Nicodemus brought a mixture of myrrh and aloe, about 75 pounds. Taking Jesus' body, the two of them wrapped it, with the spices, in the strips of linen. This was in accordance with Jewish burial customs. At the place where Jesus was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb, in which no one had ever been laid. Because it was the Jewish day of preparation, and since the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Thanks, Heather. Thanks, Jay. It's always good to hear the word of God. Amen. Well, I have to ask you, have you ever received a letter at your home saying that you have been pre-qualified for a loan? Or maybe you have received a letter that says you have been pre-qualified for such and such credit card, up to $5,000, let's say. Who hasn't received probably at least three of those this week, right? I mean, if you think about it, it's kind of a scam. These companies are sending this to you because they've decided you would be just the greatest customer. And, you know, I got to admit, the first couple of those that I got, I thought, hey, I am really something now. And then you realize that it's kind of a trick, isn't it? That they just want to give you this loan or give you this charge card so that they can charge you interest when you fail to pay your bill. Now, you may say, oh, well, I always pay my bill, and you very well may, but the rest of the world frequently does not. And therein is the ploy, right? It's a joke, it's a jip, if you don't know how to manage things. They're just trying to get you to spend money so they can charge you interest. I also want you to think about pre-qualified from a Christian standpoint. Because God has pre-qualified every one of you for salvation. Are you aware of that? You are pre-qualified for eternity. Hallelujah! Amen! You see, God has pre-qualified us by already applying the righteousness of Christ to our eternal account. Isn't that awesome? Not because of anything you have done, or I have done, or we have done, but because Jesus was the perfect sacrifice. And the credit for Christ's perfect sacrifice sits within your pre-qualified account from God. Amen? Now there is an account worth being pre-qualified on. Amen? Amen. Well, there's a lot of scripture here, and I'm not going to take the time to go through all of it. But I do want to hit on some high points, if you will. You know, clearly the arm of the Lord that was in the scripture that Heather read about is obviously about to be revealed. We've had hints about this arm of the Lord, right? Where God, in each case, has promised to deliver not just His own people, but the entire world. The arm of the Lord can and will protect and or save not just the Jewish people, but the Gentiles as well. So this servant is the arm of the Lord. In Isaiah, we keep hearing about the servant. The servant who is this, the servant who is that. If you go back and read all of Isaiah, he refers to the servant in several ways. So the servant in today's scripture was the arm of the Lord that had been promised to the people. All the people. All the people of the world. But that report or that opportunity was not believed. No one believed it. Right? Why wouldn't they believe in this servant who was going to be the arm of the Lord? Three reasons. First, he comes on to the scene in a quiet and unassuming way. You can look that up in Isaiah 53, verse 2. So there wasn't this massive fanfare, and he wasn't this rock star kind of personality, if you will. No. The servant shows up in a quiet and unassuming way. Christ didn't ride a horse into Jerusalem. What did he ride? Yeah, a colt. Just a colt of a donkey. It's pretty humble, wouldn't you say? Pretty unassuming. The second reason people didn't believe is that he has no extraordinary beauty or attractiveness that is going to draw people to him. His appearance, it says in Isaiah, is quite ordinary. You say, well, does that make a big difference? Well, actually, it did at times. Saul was selected the king of Israel because of his stature, his height, his appearance. That was part of it. The third reason the servant was not believed is he's rejected because he's taking on the pain and the suffering of the world. He is willing to take on the pain and the suffering of the entire world. Now, we on this side of the cross say, well, what an excellent thing for the servant to do. You have to remember, they're not on the same side of the cross that we're on. They're on the front side of the cross. Before Jesus had been crucified, before he rose again. And all they see is someone who maybe is weak. I mean, after all, if this man could die on a cross, was he really the servant, the arm of the Lord? And you have to remember, on Good Friday evening, all they knew was that this man that people called Jesus had been crucified on a cross and died. It's a totally different place where we sit on this side of the cross, isn't it? Most of us find pain and suffering disturbing, both because we don't like to observe it. We want to be empathetic. We want to be sympathetic. But honestly, we really don't know how to provide condolence to those who are going through pain and suffering, do we? We struggle with that. The other thing that it does to us or for us, depending on how you want to look at it, is it reminds us of our own mortality, our own ability to fall into circumstances where there is pain and suffering involved. And so for this arm of the Lord to be subjected to pain and suffering, honestly, on the front side of the cross, the people just didn't really want to recognize it. We try to ignore pain and suffering. In the scripture, it talks about hiding your face. We try not to think about pain and suffering. In the scripture, it said, we esteemed him not. We just didn't want to think about him. The servant has come to take away the sins of the world, but no one really is paying attention to this arm of the Lord, because he doesn't meet their standard. Their standard was that somebody was going to come in power, probably military power, and rescue them from their political oppressors, the Romans. So this servant, this arm of the Lord, didn't fit in their box. In those same scripture, though, it talks about God allowing his son to be crushed. Those of you who are parents, can you imagine how it must feel to allow a child to be crushed, to be dealt such a harsh life or death? I think the only way you could justify that would be that if it occurred because of a greater good, right? If you lost a child while they were saving their schoolmates' lives, if you lost a child while they died for a greater good, yeah, that might help. And what greater good could this arm of the Lord, this servant arm of the Lord, be bringing to the people? Well, again, on this side of the cross, it's obvious that the answer is given in the second half of the verse when it says, it is when the life of the servant is offered as a sin offering that God's purpose in bringing him to this place, cross on Golgotha, that's when it's realized, the greater good. Think back to the time that Jesus and some of the disciples spent in the Garden of Gethsemane. That garden and that prayer and that time together made it clear that the servant's death was indeed the Father's will. And his own words uttered at the Last Supper demonstrate that he understood his death to be a substitutionary one. Jesus' death was a substitutionary death. Substitutionary for who? We all got to raise our hand, folks.
He died for us. All of us. That night in the upper room, Jesus, as he was sharing the bread and the wine, right? Remember when he said, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." Jesus' blood took the place of yours and mine. Yeah? Sure did. We're called to be servants. If you were here last night, you would have heard that we're called to be humble servants like Christ was a humble servant. But in our servanthood, we can't redeem. Christ's servanthood redeemed the world. We're called to be servants as well, but we can't redeem the world. Jesus alone is the Redeemer. When we consider John and the scriptures that Jay read, the entire world, both Jews and Gentiles, were condemned to death, an eternal death. And yet, because of the servant, arm of the Lord, Jews as well as Gentiles could be saved. The entire world. What John's trying to tell us in his gospel is that not only has Jesus sacrificed for all of them, but also in this story, if you go back and read the account, it was both Jew and Gentile that put Christ on the cross. He died for Jew and Gentile, but it was Jew and Gentile that placed him on the cross for his death. Jesus is the servant, the arm of the Lord. He loves you with a love that knows no equal. His humility is such that what a man, what a God. If you read the account, it says of those who God gave him, those people that God gave to Jesus, he didn't lose one. And when you read the accounts that we read tonight, twice Jesus makes his captors understand that he alone is the one they want. He didn't want his disciples getting caught up in what was about to happen. God gave him those disciples, and Jesus didn't lose one of them. Twice, when he had the opportunity, he took charge of the situation and said, "Who is it you're looking for?" "Jesus of Nazareth. I'm him." Sure, he was being truthful, but he was making sure that those whom God had given him had safety. There's a story that one day a little boy was lost, couldn't find his way home. He began to cry. A stranger saw the little boy there on the street crying, and he came up and tried to comfort him.
He said, "What's wrong, son?" And the little boy said, through a flood of tears, I can't find my way home. I'm lost." And wanting to help, the man began asking a few questions. "Do you know your address?" "No." "Can you tell me something about where you live? Is there anything close to your house?" And the little boy said, "Well, there's a big building that has a cross on it." And he described it to the man. And then the man knew. And by the time he got the little boy to that church with the cross on top of it, he knew where he was at. He immediately found his way home. And folks, it's that way for us as well. That until we find the cross, until we realize that Jesus is the servant, the arm of God, that we're going to struggle to get home. But when you find the cross and you find Jesus and you find that servant, that arm of God, He'll take you home to your forever home. Jesus said, "I go and prepare a place for you. And if I do that, I'll come and take you to be with me." And all God's people said, "Amen." Amen.
I was reading a documentary about the Roman soldiers, that empire. And they took pride in creating strife and pain. They had soldiers that were, their job was to make these whips. They called them cat of nine tails. And they started out real long and they started making them shorter. And they would sew like arrowheads into the leather and sharpen bone. And they made them, they only made them about this long, because when they brought it down on the person's back, it stuck. And then they pulled it down. And it ripped your flesh. And they gave 40 lashes. But they got so good at this pain and this whipping that they decided it would be 40 minus 1. Wasn't that nice of them? But that's the human race, that's us. And then crucifixion. The way they put you on the cross. And the pressure that it caused on your heart. Would let the blood flow freely into your heart, but it wouldn't let it out. And many people died from their heart exploding. Well, when Christ was on that cross, He already had a broken heart like we know. You know, if you ever lost someone that you loved, or they hurt you, you get this pain, this real pain in your heart. And I was sure Christ had that. And then they put him, we put him, on a cross. And he saved us. In spite of those things, he saved us. He gave us his life for you and me.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you. Let us pray. We are so thankful, God, that you overlooked our inequities. And how heartless we were for recognizing that we needed you so much. Thank you, God, except. Except that you can be the most important thing in our life. That you should be the most important thing in our life. A creator. Loves his creation. And died out of love for it to save us. So that God could look through the blood of Jesus and see you and me. Our sins were paid. So, Lord, thank you. We need you, Lord, and we worship you, Lord. And we're so needy, and you fulfill all our needs. Thank you, Lord, for watching over us. Build this church, Lord. Show us how others can see you in us. Use us, Lord. Give us courage. We've been redeemed. In Jesus' precious and holy name. Amen. Say the Lord's Prayer with me, please. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. It's not the temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
If you would, rise with us, if you're able, or rise with us in spirit. Turn in your hymnal to number 288. 288. Were you there? Please be seated. I'm going to ask those who were willing to help us with our exercise at the altar today to go ahead and come forward. What we're about to do is to strip the altar. And it is, in essence, symbolic of Christ being emptied out. As we strip the altar and that is concluded, I would ask you to leave tonight's ceremony in silence, contemplating what Christ did for us on a Good Friday, a couple thousand years ago. Christ, His holy and perfect Son, and through the power of the Holy Spirit, let us leave this place remembering what Jesus has done for you and for the world. He emptied Himself out so that you might live. Go in peace, go in love. Amen and amen.